be a winner.
Take by Montel Goodwin, gets the steal, gives Mike Davis for three. No good. Rebounded by Wilson. Wilson put back up and in.
Please come on, support Lakeland's women's soccer as they face Lake Michigan College Saturday, September 22nd at 1 p.m. For more information about Lakeland Athletics, please visit athletics.lakelandcc.edu. Go Lakers!
Military veteran students who study at Lakeland first meet with a Veterans Affairs certifying official who processes and certifies educational benefits for eligible students. The staff has been phenomenal, said Lakeland student Michael Dugan, who is a retired chief petty officer from the U.S. Coast Guard. The Veterans Lounge is a great place to frequent prior to class. It's great to be able to show up a few hours early, do some final prep, enjoy a snack, and be able to meet fellow veterans. A generous grant from Wells Fargo Advisors, LLC, helped to set up a Veterans Lounge in 2013. The space, complete with study areas, a computer and printer, a refrigerator, and a television, serve as a meeting point for student veterans on campus to connect. Each May, graduating student veterans are recognized at the college's Veterans Recognition and Graduation Banquet.
All right, how you doing today, Lakeland? This is Adorable Deplorables here with Mike and Matt in the morning. Go ahead, Matt.
That's right, Mike and Matt. M&M. Yeah.
So, we were supposed to do a show on Tuesday.
And that didn't happen.
And that didn't happen, so yeah. Unfortunately.
Not because of me. Maybe it was. I don't know. I had to work. Yeah, I did. I worked.
You had to work.
I think. No, I was here. No, I wasn't here. I was here yesterday.
So you just missed the show?
Yeah.
Give me a second. I think my mic's on. Is my mic on? Is it good?
Are you
good?
Yeah, your mic's on.
Okay, just making sure.
I think. Okay. Let me hear.
Yeah, you need to put your headphones on. That's
We're definitely.
We good?
Yeah, we're definitely in the the preliminary stages of the technology of this show.
Yeah, things definitely change a little bit. It's not the same as it used to be. So, but
yeah. So, it was a lot easier before.
So last week we were talking about how we were going to do a show on the rise of communism in the United States here on Adorable Deplorables. So
yeah,
what's your take on communism, Matt?
It doesn't work. My God, people want to sit here all day. Oh, we need communism. I'm on the left. I need it. No, listen. All right. No, communism doesn't work. And for those of you that believes that it does,
which most Christians
call do. In. We would love to argue with you.
Yeah, that's what I want to reiterate on last week. You know. Because there's sometimes people who view the stream, and we know how college students are. Free stuff means that's where I'm getting put my vote. So if you have any complaints or you want to come on the show and debate one of us, by all means, we welcome you. We welcome you to come right up.
Definitely.
You can even come up to our window here and just start slamming on the window, calling us Nazis or whatever, and we'll let you right in. So because that's how most people here are. As soon as you don't agree with something, you're automatically a Nazi. You're automatically this horrible person. Which it's called basic knowledge. Communism doesn't work.
Common sense.
My favorite thing about communism is it's a system where you try it, it doesn't work, but that's okay because it wasn't real socialism. So you do it again, but it doesn't work, but that's okay because it wasn't real socialism. And it's just an endless it's an endless cycle. So
You look at the countries that have adopted communism as their type of government.
Absolutely.
Look at China.
Well, it's not even just China. I mean, you can look at even democratic socialist countries, and that's who Bernie Sanders. That's who most college students depiction of Jesus is Bernie Sanders. But Bernie Sanders is the biggest moron on the planet. I honestly would even go as far to say that I think he's a bigger moron than Hillary Clinton, because at least Hillary Clinton, and this is the one thing I'm giving that witch.
Okay,
is that at least she's not a socialist. I mean, she's a socialist, but at least she's not working to get to communism. Bernie Sanders is a designated communist. We know this.
Here's where I'll agree and disagree with you on that. So the difference between Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders, which was very evident, was Sanders was more, he was more, how should I put it? He was less of established than her. She was more, she had deals with other countries, she had ties to other world leaders, and she also was somewhat socialist, but at the same time, she was still for free trade and things of that nature, whereas Bernie was, okay, everything's got to be free.
Everything's got to be free.
You know, I mean,
I think that's what I was going to say.
And every time he talked, I thought he was going to fall over. I mean, seriously, he was hunched over already. They made the Hunchback of Notre Dame about him. And seriously, I just thought that Bernie was going to. I actually was at a Trump rally in 2016. Really? And there were a couple of Bernie supporters that were protesting. And my favorite thing, bye-bye, birdies. Get them out of here. Bye-bye, birdies. I thought he was saying bye-bye, birdies. I'm like looking for birds flying in the air like, oh, they're protesting too. Okay. No, but I mean, like, wow. You know, it was funny. But I mean, I actually started out a Bernie supporter.
Really?
Yeah, when the election first
rethink
started.
This friendship.
Actually, yeah. Wait a minute. Let's go back in time, Mike.
Let's go back in time.
I'm a communist this week.
No, but I actually started out a Bernie supporter in, actually, my first semester here in 2015. The candidates started to come alive and who was going to run and, you know, who, you know, all that. And Trump was actually, you know, just kind of a name. He wasn't actually, like, president, you know.
Right.
And so also the thing about it was that Bernie Sanders was coming high into the ranks and everyone was like, okay, Hillary's gonna win, there's no doubt about it. And then Bernie started to make his way into the conversation, and that's when I started to be like, all right, I don't want Hillary. Nobody wants Hillary.
No, right.
Only people who know Hillary want Hillary. So
even her own husband doesn't.
Even
want
her own.
I do not have sexual relations with that woman.
Man, Bill Clinton, dude, what a guy.
Did you see the I think it was Aretha Franklin's funeral? Did you see that? How he was looking
was
at Ariana
terrible.
Grande?
Yeah, he is a disgusting human being.
Well, I tweeted. I said, gentlemen, get you a girl that looks at you the way Bill Clinton at Ariana Grande.
I'm like, oh my God. Looking at Ariana Grande, and I swear.
She wants to see something grande.
Oh,
but that was, I mean,
yeah.
That skeleton of Bill Clinton, just the way he looks, just amazing. Anyway, so communism.
Yeah. We're getting off topic. We'll save Bill Clinton for another episode.
Oh, yes, please.
Oh, we have a lot. So the main thing about communism is that it doesn't work. And one of the things that a lot of people forget, especially college students,
mm-hmm.
is that the amount of deaths that occurred because of communism. For starters, number one, this is actually a article that talks about this, and it's a really good article, a historian on the warpath. Communism body count, number one, the People's Republic of China, the very same country that most people say, when you say, oh, communism isn't around anymore, you know, it doesn't,
right.
It doesn't work. Not around, it's around, but it doesn't work. People say, well, look at China, it works. Well, first of all.
Yeah, and China also has a one child per couple.
Exactly.
Law. It's exactly. Law. The government mandates your birth.
Exactly.
So, okay, we'll go with that.
Yeah, it's disgusting. And this is their body count. This is how many people have killed. And you have to remember, with Mao Zedong, when he took power, the Great Leap Forward was one of the biggest disasters in human history. It was this communist idea of collectivization. We know communism is collectivization. Collect all, you know, everything for the state, everything for the, you know, for one person. And he went on this thing about, basically, I think it was subsidizing the farmers or something, taking their land. But when you take their land, how are you going to eat?
Right,
you're the farmers,
right.
You know? So this Great Leap Forward completely went straight to, you know, South End. So, you know, this is their body count, 73,237,000. Yeah. That's a lot of people dead. And that's what communism is. Number two, of course, is the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. You know, 58 million right there.
Right.
Third is actually the Russian Soviet Federated Socialist Republic. This was Russia before it became the Soviet Union. This is right after the Russian Civil War.
Right.
3 million dead.
Okay.
North Korea, of course, they would be up there. Number four, 3 million. Cambodia, yeah. 2.62 million.
Cambodia, man.
I mean, the list goes on. The list goes on. And the thing is that people forget this. And one of the biggest things that I can't stand is people don't know about the massacre of Holodomor, which was
I don't think I know about that.
You don't know? Okay, so the Soviet Union under Joseph Stalin, and Stalin was a nut job in his own right.
Wait. We need video of you from like a year ago, and I could just be like, oh, wait, flashback. And for our flashback. Listeners, Mike was, never mind. We'll discuss past.
I dwelled on the left side of the spectrum, let's just say that.
And it was I saw the literally light. The greatest thing. Literally, Mike was.
Changed in a week.
Yeah, I think it was spring semester of.
Spring semester.
This past year?
This past year.
And Mike was, well, before that he was a socialist. After that he was a communist. And then it was spring break. We had a week off. And I come back. He's like, Trump is the best. And I'm like, wait, whoa, what happened? Whoa, dude. I got hit with the hurricane that's coming in, like, by Mike. Geez. Like, Florence. Florence just knocked me over on my butt. Yeah. But go ahead anyway.
Hey, they know what they should, speaking about last week, we should stop putting genders to our hurricanes, okay? Let them decide for themselves. All right.
That's what we should do, Mike. Florence. We should go up to the hurricane and be like, hey, what do you identify as today? We got to know for the news.
We got hurricane. Just, I think I'm going to be Haley today.
That already happened. Choose another one. Banana. Okay. Yeah, that works. Hurricane banana.
So this is the Holodomor. So this was Joseph Stalin. I believe during World War II, the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic. Stalin ordered the NKVD and the Red Army to go into Ukraine and just slaughter millions of men, women, and children.
Hmm.
And it's honestly what's fascinating about this is actually that historians say that Joseph Stalin, single-handedly with Holodomor, slaughtered more people than the Holocaust.
The more you say that guy's name, I'm hearing Voldemort. So
Joseph Stalin?
No, the other.
Oh, Holodomor.
Voldemort.
Well, that was just what the massacre was called.
The Voldemort massacre. There's some Harry Potter stuff, man.
So this is what communism does.
Harry Potter was actually Chinese. Conspiracy.
Harry Potter was indeed a Bolshevik.
It was Daniel Radcliffe sitting there like, what? Go ahead. Wingardium Leviosa.
We must play Quidditch, comrade.
No, Wingardium Leviosa.
Wingardium Leviosa, comrade. So this is communism. And one of the most important things is that when you have these hip and cool, trendy democratic socialists, you know, appealing to the young masses, everyone forgets that socialism's end goal is communism. Doesn't matter what kind of, you can be radical socialist, you can be democratic socialist, whatever it is, socialism, the end goal is communism.
Mm-hmm.
And the end goal of communism is disaster.
Yep.
And then the end goal of disaster is to try it again.
Well, if you think about it, so I was talking to this guy about, I was actually at work, and this guy needed some parts, and he was from Germany, which is where I'm German.
Yeah.
So what sucks is that this guy's telling me he's probably about 80 years old, right? And he's walking, you know, he could barely move. And it's like a half an hour before we close. And the guy comes up to me, he goes, hey, so, you know, are you in college? I'm like, yeah. He goes, over in my country, college is free. And I'm like, okay, that's great. And he's like, you don't pay for anything. Literally, your apartment's paid for, you know. Right? He's like, everything's free. Everything's great. I'm like, so where do they get the money for that? He's like, the government. I'm like, oh, yeah? So that sounds really great. He's like, it is. It's amazing. The government loves us. I'm like, really? This just sounds horrible. And it saddens me. Because I've always wanted to live in Germany. I've always wanted to go to Germany or at least visit it. And after, you know, Trump got into office, we kind of, you know, have a very odd relationship with Germany because of Merkel and how she thinks, how she acts, things that she has passed.
We can designate a whole week on Angela Merkel. Oh, God.
Oh, man, yeah. But I mean, it's just, it's bad. It's really bad in what's happening in Germany, you know, government-wise and some of the laws they've passed. It saddens me because that's my homeland. You know, that's my place. I mean, my homeland is also Ireland and Russia, but that's, you know, for another day. I collude with Russia. I do.
You collude
with Russia. Hey, I have Russian in me now. It may be like two, no, it's actually, actually, my aunt told me it's 14% or something like that. And I'm like, dude, hell yeah. Like,
question is,
seriously.
Is it Red Russian or White Russian? Because that's the issue here. White Russian being the old monarchists, you know, and the Red Russians, of course, being the dirty commies. So
hey,
that's the question.
Hey, let me tell you something. I would, if Putin was here right now, I would shake his hand, I'd go have lunch with him, and I'd hang out with the guy. The guy literally catches fish swimming in the water with his shirt off. You see all these pictures of him on a bear and his shirt's off. He's like, You know, he's sitting there like, hey, this is what I do every day. You know, I'm like, yeah, this dude's cool. Now, forget all the other stuff, you know. I have people telling me, oh, he's a bad guy, he kills people. You don't even think about it. That's hearsay.
Journalists don't deserve to live.
Journalists don't know what they're doing.
Let's be
CNN,
honest here,
come on. It's all fake news. Putin probably Putin has a butterfly collection. Come on now.
We keep getting off topic here, but
yeah, we do.
One of my favorite things about speaking of journalists is really CNN put out an article, and I hope some of our student veterans are here listening to this because this is hilarious.
Yeah.
And by the way, student veterans, I want to thank you for your service.
Yes, thank you very much.
I'm so happy that you have a club here.
Yes, it's well deserved.
Yeah, but one of the people who don't thank you is CNN because CNN put out an article saying journalists are more braver than our U.S. soldiers. They did. You can look it up. CNN put out an article saying that journalists are in the fire constantly. Okay. Fire of words or fire of bullets? Let's see here. Who has done more for our country?
Yeah. It's weird because so they have this agenda with and this could, you know, fly back to the Colin Kaepernick thing that's going on.
Oh, God. Yeah.
You look at that and you combine that with now CNN and their coverage of it. And what upsets me horribly is that the way that CNN covers anything that has to do with the national anthem controversy,
mm-hmm.
it makes the soldiers look bad. It makes them look like they haven't done anything for the country. It makes them look like they have sacrificed nothing and that a simple citizen by kneeling has sacrificed everything. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's just so unjust. To me, that's such a spit in the face and the most disrespectful thing you could do for people who literally volunteer to go into the military, get on the ground, face death almost mm-hmm. every single day, come back home, thankfully, because they survived, and then get treated like they didn't do anything.
Right.
And they come back with PTSD and other diseases and other, you know, mental issues, physical issues. Some of them lose limbs, you know, and it's
absolutely.
Just, and it's, you know, last time I checked, you know, you don't lose a limb by playing for the 49ers, you know, you don't. And
yeah.
And I feel as though CNN really does a disservice to those that actually give CNN the right to, you know,
well, you know what I call CNN, Clinton National News.
Yeah.
That's literally what it is. It's pretty much.
Yeah, it's controlled.
Yeah. But we are getting off topic. We'll designate that for another, definitely for another show, because I'd like to get on that with the anthem.
Definitely,
and
definitely.
But, you know, I think we're going to take a break here.
Okay.
I do have a video. I'm sure everyone knows who she is. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. The Democrats' new golden child, because Bernie's old, washed up, wrinkly bones is going to make it to the next election. We know this, so they're putting all their money on this Alexandria chick, and I don't know what's more scarier, her policies or how big her eyes are. Let's be honest here. But I have a video of her, and it's
her eyes.
But I have a video I want to play of her. It was an interview. She has no idea what she's talking about. Trying to ask her what her policies are and how she's going to implement free things for everybody is a joke. So we're going to stop here. We'll catch right back up after a few.
Did you say castrate?
What? We'll catch back up.
Oh, I thought you said castrate. I'm like, whoa, wait, I didn't sign up for this.
I didn't sign up for this.
We were going to do this show.
We'll catch right back up.
All right, so. Yeah. Catch back up, not castrate. Remember that.
We're not China here. All right.
There can only be one.
The Lakeland Community College Civic Theater presents A Little Night Music by Stephen Sondheim. The summer night smiles three times. First on the young, second on the full, and third on the old. A Little Night Music will be held on September 7th 8th, 14th, 15th, 21st, 22nd, 28th, and 29th at 7:30 p.m. and September 9th, 16th, 23rd, and 30th at 2 p.m. Tickets are $15 for adults, $13 for seniors, and $7 for students. Call 440-525-7134 or visit lakelandcc.edu/arts to order tickets. Taking my soak into the masses, writing my poems for the few that look at me, took to me, shook at me, feeling me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins, speaking my lesson from the brain, seeing the beauty through the...
So we are back here on Adorable Deplorables.
We are.
All right. So we are running a little bit late here.
Yes, we are.
Thanks to Matt here.
All Tim's fault.
All Tim's fault. So we're going to play a quick video. We're going to play a quick video here, and then we're going to wrap it up here. This is just, like I said, this is Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez absolutely making a fool of herself. So
yes.
We're just going to give a quick couple minutes to listen. And
grab some popcorn. Listen to the BS.
Let's hear some commies talk. So just go ahead and hit the plate. Alrighty.
That's right. Turn the mics off.
I don't believe that in a moral and wealthy America, people should be too poor to live.
I can't let you go. She's looking at herself on television right now. How are you feeling? Can you put it into words?
Nope. I cannot put this into words.
You are from
from the Bronx, born and raised. You actually represent and live in the community that you hope to represent in Congress when we see all too often Congress members not even living in their district, like your opponent. What does it mean for you to have effective representation like that?
There's been so many, especially working class people in the Bronx that are so excited. I went to my bodega last night and people were just excited and clapping. I think it just means a lot to be seen and to feel seen and to feel like one of you, a representative from your community that cares, that stays there, has a voice in what's going on.
Most of your fundraising was small donations and you refused to take corporate PAC money. Why was that so important to you?
I wanted to be a 100% accountable representative to my community. I believe that the role of money in politics is really degrading our democracy and hurting our ability to have effective government. There's a lot you can do without money. You can knock on your neighbor's door without money. You can make phone calls without money. And that's just what we did for a really, really long time.
As this race goes on to the midterms, do you see a scenario where you're gonna have to start taking corporate money, and would you do it?
I won't. Like, I am totally fine working with political organizations, but the line that I want to draw is pretending that I am neutral in policy making when I'm taking money from one side that has a vested for-profit interest.
You're running on a Medicare for all, free public college, federal jobs guarantee. Which is the top priority for you, and how are you gonna pay for this?
That's always the question. How are we gonna pay for it? War is very expensive too, and we never ask about that. We only ask how we're gonna pay for things when we're talking about taking care of people. The GOP tax cut cost the United States $400 billion. You know what you could have done with $400 billion? You could have forgiven every single federal student loan debt in America. That's what you could have done with $400 billion. We want improved and expanded Medicare for all. We want tuition-free public colleges and trade schools. We want a Green New Deal to address climate change. I'm an idealist in my goals. I'm an idealist in my vision, and I'm very pragmatic about how I get there. I don't believe that in a moral and wealthy America, people should be too poor to live. I find that to be an unacceptable state, that you can be too poor to see a doctor, that you can be too poor to send your child to a school that actually gives them options for their future. And I want to live in a society that does not fail people's most basic needs to live. And so that for me is my, you know, it's about dignity.
You call for the abolishment of ICE. And I think a lot of people forget that ICE hasn't really been around all that long. It was born out of the so-called war on terror. It's been around since 2003 only. But what do you see as a replacement for ICE?
I think that immigration should be safe. I think that we should grant people a safe and documented right of passage. Republicans try all these scare tactics and they go, oh, open borders, you know, because they're trying to incite fear. But what we really need to do is demilitarize a lot of what's going on in terms of the detention of people, which has been happening for a very long time, by the way. And so I think that when we talk about replacing it with a system, we need to talk about really having a system that is safe, that documents people effectively, that is also not rooted in the discrimination that our immigration system was initially built on. The first immigration law in the United States was the Chinese Exclusion Act. The first law about immigration in the United States was, how do we exclude a specific type of people? And our immigration system has really kind of evolved from that, I think, initial root. And I don't think it necessarily has to be that way.
Days before your election, you left New York and you went down to the southern border to protest these family separations that we're seeing. And you said the moral character of our nation is on the line.
Right now, the nation that we are living in is a country that, and an administration that has committed international human rights abuses by separating children from their parents.
Okay, so
we have to finish up early.
We have to finish up here early, but one of the quick things
early?
I want
to...
Early? Turn on mic three.
Turn on mic three. Early? You mean 20 minutes late? That's Mr. Bossman?
Yeah,
here's the thing, okay? This is my show.
All right, mute mic
it's
two.
The greatest show. No, don't mute
Turn
it.
Turn off if mic you... two. Okay, so one of the quick things I just want to say really quick is that from this video is it's funny how notice a trend here with Miss Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. She never explains how she's going to give out free stuff.
Yeah.
She never explains.
Well, and that's also the thing is that there's the underlining lie in that,
right?
Because it's going to come from everybody else that has the money to pay for things.
Absolutely.
So, and that's the problem with communism is that how are you going to pay for things? Well, the government. How's the government going to get money? The people. Wait a minute. How does that work?
Exactly.
You know,
they think they can just create money just by simply writing down a number.
I mean, you could go to the Treasury and just print money and see how that works.
But then that revolves in was it inflation?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
exactly.
So it's a flawed system. That has no place in America and no place in the West.
That's right.
So I think we're going to end on that.
Yeah.
So, well, thank you so much for tuning
Communism
in.
Communism is wrong and you cannot change our minds.
You cannot change our minds. Thank you for tuning in with Adorable Deplorables.
That's the difference between Crowder and us. He's open to getting our minds changed, or his mind changed. We're not.
All right, guys. Have a great rest of your day.